Joshua chapter 11. We are going to kind of finish up here. I'll talk a little bit about the end of Joshua chapter 10, which is really a continuance into the first five verses of chapter 11. We're going to see some things here in this warfare that's going on here. And there's a challenge that comes up here to Joshua after he has the greatest victory there with the sun standing still, right? And he sees the miraculous deliverance of God there. And you would think that after that, it would be smooth sailing and there would be no opposition, no strong opposition, and it wouldn't affect him so greatly, or there wouldn't be like surely there wouldn't be a mounted up challenge to Joshua and his inheritance. But that's really what we're going to talk about. I titled this sermon, Hold Fast, Saint, because Satan will challenge your inheritance. And here's where the inheritance is challenged. And the picture that you're going to see, and then the picture of you and I in our spiritual walk in our lives, that the devil comes to challenge your inheritance. That's going to happen. There's going to be many challenges until you get home. And we'll read kind of these first five verses here. And it came to pass when Jabin, king of Hazor, had heard those things, that he sent to Jobab, king of Madon, and the king of Shimron, and to the king of Akshaph, and to the kings that were on the north of the mountains and of the plains, south of Chinnereth, and in the valley, and in the border of Dor on the west, and to the Canaanite on the east and on the west, and to the Amorite, and to the Hittite, and the Perizzite, and the Jebusite in the mountains, and to the Hivite under Hermon in the land of Mizpah. And they went out, and they all and their host with them, much people, even as the sand that is upon the seashore in multitude, with horses and chariots very many. And when all the kings were met together, they came and pitched together at the waters of Merom to fight against Israel. Now, at the end of chapter 10 here, we see Joshua, he starts to get victory here. He's got victory going. The sun is standing still, right? And God extends that day out and great victory comes. And then they continue to fight on. And the Lord delivered it also. And the king thereof in verse 30 of the last chapter in chapter 10, the king thereof in the hand of Israel, and he smote it with the edge of the sword, and all the souls that were therein, let none remain in it. And he did unto the king thereof as he did unto the king of Jericho. So he goes on and on and on. And Joshua passed from Libnah, and all Israel with him into Lachish, and encamped against it, and fought against it. And the Lord delivered Lachish into the hand of Israel, which took him the second day. So you're seeing a pattern here. He goes in, he conquers, God delivers them, and they continue on in victory. Then in verse number 33, then Horam, king of Gezer, came, an old Gezer, and he came up to help Lachish, and Joshua smote him and his people until he had left him none remaining. And from Lachish, Joshua passed unto Eglon, and all Israel with him, and they encamped against it and fought against it. And they took it on that day, and they smote it with the edge of the sword. And all the souls that were therein, he utterly destroyed that day, according to all that he had done to Lachish. And Joshua went up unto Eglon, and all Israel with him unto Hebron, and they fought against it. And they took it, and they smote it. So you see a pattern here. They go up, they war, they take it, they smite it. You would think after driving through like a freight train that they are, that there wouldn't be any problems. Like these kings are going to be like, all right, we're done with this. We don't want to fight these guys anymore. We're not going to challenge Joshua's right to Canaan. We're going to stop right now. We're just going to submit and we're going to surrender and we're not going to challenge because he's defeated all these kings. The first five kings in a cave, he destroyed them. And these other five or six kings, how many ever there are, he's destroyed them. He's went through and he's gotten victory all the way through and we're done. But that's not the case. And by the way, let me say this to you. It will never be the case. Your enemies and the enemies of your salvation and Satan will never, never stop challenging your inheritance until you get home. He will never stop. Right? He'll never stop. And that's what you find here. Now all these kings mount up as the sand of the sea, right? So that means, what is he saying? That's a lot of people. That's a lot of troops. That's a lot of kings. That's a lot of people coming after them, and you think that the worst of it was behind you, right? And you think that sometimes in your Christian life, if you've been through so many battles, if you've seen so many victories, that all of that stuff has got to be behind you now. It's not going to be as bad. It must be smooth sailing. Now I can kind of breathe and I can, you know, just enjoy that life and everything else that is there. And it's not the case. There is no time on this earth. Let me be clear with you. There is no time on this earth that you can lay your armor down. There isn't your spiritual armor. You don't get to lay it down. You don't get to rest on your laurels. You don't get to rest on past victories. You don't need to go. You don't get to rest. All of the manna that fell from the sky yesterday, that's moldy bread now. And you don't get to rest in any of that. You have to continue on, and you have to press on, and you have to fight on, and you don't get to do that. There isn't any time where you're going to be able to do that in this life, where your enemies are all just gonna, they're just gonna surrender and give up, and Satan's not gonna fight you for your inheritance. No, you will fight for every inch of your inheritance until you get home. You will fight for every inch of it until you go home. Until you die, you will fight for every inch of it. That's just the way it's going to be. And you have to remember that. Joshua, if anything, this book of Joshua teaches you is that there's a war, you're going to fight it, and you're going to continue to fight it until you're gone. Until you leave, until you die. Then death frees you from the battle. The battle's no more. And your body lays in the grave and your soul goes on to be with the Lord. Right? But until then, you fight. Until then, you war. Until then, you battle. And that's the lesson here, that you and I are to hold fast. That's what we're to do, because Satan will challenge your inheritance. Father in heaven, Lord, please help us. Speak to our hearts and strengthen us today, as we all need it so badly, as we move forward this new year, Lord, this second day of the year, as we press on. Help us to do so. In Jesus, forgive us our sins, cleanse us of our unrighteousness. Strengthen our hearts. Help us to be useful to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, in our last message, we watched Israel become victorious against five kings in a cave, right? God gave them the victory. They're marching forward. We saw some wonderful pictures of God's power and his deliverance and everything else. But now in chapter 11, we find Joshua and all Israel being challenged by another and greater and bigger confederacy of enemies that have come together to challenge Joshua's inheritance. They are literally challenging his right to the land. They are challenging his right, his deed, his to his property, to what God has promised and given him, right? They're challenging it. So number one, what we find here, we find Satan pictured in this. We find here that there are no extraordinary deliverances. That in this case, I mean, every deliverance is miraculous in its own right. But in this case, this is a battle that they have to fight. Like, God is not making it so smooth of sailing through like he did the other enemies. It shows you the diversity of spiritual warfare. It shows you the diversity of this Christian life, that there is a diversity to it. There are challenges, there are different battles that you will face and you will fight until you go home. Here we find that Joshua wars against all these kings, and he's given that victory from about the end of chapter 10 until now. Joshua just continues to march on. But you must remember one thing. Much of your warfare in this life will just be marching on in consistent faithfulness to the Lord. You know what? A true test of your walk with God is not the miraculous deliverances. It's not all the mighty signs and wonders. You know what it is? It's getting up in 15 below weather and going to church on Sunday morning. That's the battle. Right? That's the test of faithfulness in the warfare that we are in and the battle that we face. That test of faithfulness. Right? Don't think that you're always going to have extraordinary deliverances all the time, and that you don't have to just plainly fight and battle through some things. You know what you have to face? You have to fight the temptation of a mundane life. You have to fight the temptation of faithfulness every day of your life. That's the battle that you have to face. Don't lust or long for the miraculous deliverances and ignore the plain path of duty. So many try to do that. You know, charismatics, they have to invent some magical kingdom and mystical wonderland of signs and wonders and goofy things that they do. They have to invent all that stuff. And the reason why is because the plain path of duty is too boring for them. Serving Jesus Christ and living for God every day and raising your family for God, all of those things are too mundane for them. They're too ordinary for them. Faithfulness is. Joshua and his troops, they marched on. They continued to fight and war, and God continued to deliver them. Sometimes your Christian life may seem rather plain as you just go about in faithfulness to the Lord. No spectacular warfare, no special miracles taking place. But the command of God to press on. Let me tell you something. Most of your Christian life that you live will be pressing on. That will be it. It will be... Brother Paul, when people are in the military, in the services, they teach them to write march, right? You've got to do marches, right? And there's nothing more, I would assume nothing more boring than marching out and marching in and doing all these plain things, you know, of those kind of service things that you do that really, I mean, there's nothing really to it. It's just, it's like you're going to march, you're going to do this. This is what you're going to do. You're going to march on, and that's just life. That's the way it is. That's your protocol. That's what you have to follow. But you know what? This Christian life is a lot like that. You're going to march on. There's going to be times in your life that there's no other answer for you. There's nothing else clearer than you. Then you just have to keep marching on. Like there's nothing, like nothing will make sense to you. That nothing seems clear. Nothing seems understandable to you and that right, but the only command that you have from your captain is to continue to march on. That's really what it is. Turn to Philippians chapter 3, please. Paul talked about this. It was the one thing that he did. He labeled that the one thing that he did, that he was very clear about. Yea, in verse number 8, he says, yea, doubtless I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ and be found in him, not having mine own righteousness which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his sufferings being made conformable unto his death. If by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. I preached a sermon like that years ago, a couple times, probably four or five times. Never knew how much I'd need it. But four or five times I've probably preached that message, and Paul zeroes in on this thing. He says, this one thing I do. He said, in all my Christian life, in everything that... Paul was a steadfast soldier. I mean, Paul was... He just, like, pressed on. While everybody was looking for glamour shots and everything else, and selfies and everything else, you know what Paul was doing? He was marching on. He was just marching on. He just kept moving.
Right.
He wasn't chasing anything but Christ. He wasn't running after anything but Jesus. That's what he was doing. He said, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. Forgetting those things which are behind. You know, how fitting for this year as we press on and move forward, as we start a new year, that you and I remember that, and we kind of renew that commitment of understanding that your life is not in the past. Amen. Your life is forward. Your life is present. Your life is marching on. Your life is not reliving every mistake you ever made. Your life is not about going back and trying to think about every bad thing you've ever done in your life and focusing on it. Let me help you. It was all bad. That's why Jesus saved you. Done. Now move on. But it's not that simple. Oh, yes, it is that simple. Because God made it that simple. Because if it was any more complicated, you'd be really messed up. It is that simple. Right? It's that you and I just continue to press on. He said, I count not myself to apprehend, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind. and reaching forth unto those things which are before. You know what happens to people? Here's what happens to them. Maybe you're at the phase where you're still looking back. That's bad enough. But once you get over that phase and then you're in the present, the second problem you can have is not reaching forth. You're not latching on to anyone. You're to be latching on to the coattails of Christ. That's what you're supposed to be doing. You're supposed to be reaching forward. You can also get stuck in the present too. The present worries, the present concerns, the present darkness, the present discouragements, the present trials that you're in. You can be stuck there just as much as you can the past. And that's wrong too. He didn't say he just lived in the present. No. He said he reached forth unto those things which were before. Right? Which are before. He's reaching forth and he's pressing into something. I'm pressing toward the mark. Right? I'm pressing. He says, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. That's brethren, your life is ahead of you, not behind you. Your life is not behind you. That's over. Many of you have many things to lament about your past, as we all do. But I'll tell you this, you'll waste a lot of time doing it. You ought to put forth that energy to make sure the next generation does it right. Do you know that? You know what some people do? They sit around and, by the way, I preach things that upset people, as you know. And when you preach those things, people think about all the mistakes they'd made. Well, that's wonderful because you can repent of that. But guess what you have to do with that? You got to say, now I'm going to take all of that energy and all of that knowledge and understanding, and I'm going to press on to help the next generation do it right. Amen. I'm going to invest in the future, not lament the past. You see the difference? The difference is where you put your energy at. If you're putting all your energy back in the past and lamenting every mistake you ever made, well, good for you. You have the sorrow of the world. It's going to work death. You want to kill yourself? Go ahead and do that. You want to kill all your motivation, all your energy, and everything else? Lament how bad everything was and how many mistakes you made in the past and how you focus on that, and guess what you'll do? You'll destroy every bit of energy you have to do anything good in the future. You will absolutely render yourself useless. Congratulations, you've rendered yourself useless to God. Amen! I'm being real. I'm telling you, I get it. I understand. I know how you can do it. I know how it's easy to do. But it isn't profitable. It's actually a sin, by the way. You're actually sinning because you're wasting the life that God has given you on lamenting a past that God's already forgiven you for. So why would you do it? What are you yelling for? Because I'm trying to wake you up. That's why you're sleeping.
Come on, Brandon. A little cold.
Right? Trying to wake you up.
Come on.
I don't want to see you waste the rest of your life. There's too much work to do. Look around you and look at these young faces. There's too much work to do. You don't got time to do that. We don't have time to do that. The hour is dark. The night is at hand. Many are on the doorstep of eternity. We don't have time to waste in the past. We do have to give all of our energy to the future. We have work to do. And we have not many hours of light to do it in before we go home. He said, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let us therefore as many as be perfect be thus minded. Wait a minute. What does that mean? Perfect. So I got to be, if I got to be sinless then. It didn't say sinless. It said perfect. What is he talking about? Yeah, he's talking about his focus, too. He's talking about the complete whole man in Christ. Guess what you're not doing? Your mind is not focused on something else. You're not a double-minded man, unstable in all your ways, looking forward, then looking back, looking forward, then looking back, looking forward, then looking back. That's how you get a neck ache. Right? Whiplash, that's right. Looking forward, then looking back, looking forward, then looking back. I don't have anything to look back at. It was all bad. That's why Jesus saved me from it. It's all bad. That's why Jesus saved me, right? You can't do that. And you can't run a race looking behind you. You ever seen those Kenyan, those guys, not from Kenya, sorry. You Kenyans can run pretty fast too, but you ever seen those guys run? Man, they wouldn't dare look behind them. They're going like 90 miles an hour. They are running. And they ain't looking behind them either because they're running. They're pressing toward the mark. They're trying to get to the finish line. Let us therefore as many as be perfect be thus minded. What is he talking about? A perfect-minded man is not a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. He's got one goal in mind, and what's that? To cross that finish line for Christ. That's his goal. He's going to cross the finish line. She's going to cross the finish line. That's the goal. That's being perfect. That's being thus-minded. And if anything ye be otherwise-minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. Nevertheless, whereto we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us mind the same thing. Paul's saying that's what you have to do. If you, this one thing I do, why? Well, you never killed anybody. I mean, hopefully. But if you did, you'd have to be like the Apostle Paul, wouldn't you? And you'd have to press forward. And you'd have to press on. And you'd have to look forward, right? Why? Because, man, if you thought about all the people you killed and you let yourself think like that and you let yourself focus on that and you let your mind be taken by that, well, brethren, if it's not murder, it could be anything. It could be fornication, adultery. It could be lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life. It could be anything. Drunkenness, drug addict, it doesn't matter what it is. If you focus on that, that'll kill you. That'll kill you. You'll never move forward. Much of your Christian life is about you marching on. You're to press on, pilgrim. Press on. You are a pilgrim here. You're a stranger and a sojourner here. There is much land to take before we get home. And the bulk of your Christian life will be persevering through all things and pressing on. It may seem to you mothers sometimes very mundane to continue wiping noses and changing diapers. And to do your duties. It may seem very, very mundane to you. Right? That may sometimes see that. But let me say this to you. It is your duty to press on. It is of the highest importance that you do not long for a life that is like your husband's. You know, God made you different. God made you different. You're not the same. You have different roles. You have different duties, you have different strengths, you have different weaknesses. If you ever, by the way, if you're a husband and you ever foster a spirit in your wife like her life is not good enough or her life is not ideal enough and you don't fit the, and you don't teach her the proper pattern of where she's to be and where her joy is to lie and everything like that, you'll definitely breed a lot of rebellion. If you're not caring and loving for her the way that you should, you'll definitely breed a lot of rebellion and jealousy and that type of spirit. You certainly will. Absolutely you will. That'll happen. I have a concern for some of you that you're not in love with the role that God has given you. I do. I really do. As a pastor, I do, and I'll be honest with you, I look at faces, I look at things, I talk about a lot of things, I preach a lot of things, and I pray about a lot of things, and I wonder if there's not this discontent with the life that God has given you, or the role and the place that God has for you. That there's something different or something better or something that would content your soul. Listen to me, friend. If there is anything that you believe will content your soul more than the will of God for your life, you are an idolater. Because what you're saying is that the fulfillment of Christ is not enough for you. I didn't say the fulfillment of your husband meeting his responsibilities and his role the way that he should. I said Christ meeting his responsibility and his role to fulfill all of your needs. If you lean more on your husband than you do on Christ, you are an idolater. I'm going to say that again to you. If you lean more on your husband than you do on Christ, then you are an idolater. Why? Because God says that you're supposed to learn from the meek and lowly one. You're supposed to feast on Christ. You're supposed to know him. That verse, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, that's not just for men. You know that, right? Like, that's not just for men. That's for you. It's your walk with God. It's your fellowship with his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. It's you seeking Christ. It's you being fulfilled in Christ. You know what? You can be a better wife when your life is fulfilled in Christ. But if you're not daily fellowshipping with the Lord, if you're not daily communing with the Spirit, if you're not daily doing that, your husband will never make you happy. My goodness, if it was my duty to make my wife happy, I'd be in a lot of trouble. Because I don't have the capabilities of making anyone happy. You know that, right? I can't make me happy.
Right.
Amen.
Well, yeah, you can. You can make yourself happy. No, I really can't. Right? I can't. I can't. Happiness in that sense would be a fleeting moment and a circumstantial happiness. But guess what? That wears out, and then it's no good anymore. You know what? It's true joy, and that true joy comes from communion with the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
You want your marriage to thrive? You want your marriage to be successful? Then you feast on Christ. Then you get to know him. Then you grow in Christ. Then you grow your relationship in the Lord. And then you'll be more apt to see your own failings than you do your husband's. Then you'll be more apt to see your own failings than you do your wife's. Because you're putting it up against the perfect law of liberty. You're putting it up against the perfection of Christ. And you'll see your own flaws, and it'll shade the way you treat others. Let me ask you a question, you wives. This is your daily battle. This is part of your battle. Are you in love with being a wife and a mother? Or are you husbands? Are you in love with being a husband and a father with the role that God has given you? It's a good question, isn't it? Let me speak to you mothers for a moment. You're not called to do what your husband does. And let me say this to you. If you ever see your home life as a prison, then one or two things is the problem. One is your heart. And two, maybe your husband hasn't taught you right. And that's by example and by loving. Maybe he's not loving you the way that he should. But if you ever look at your home as a prison, a place of confinement in that sense, or your duty as a wife or a mother as a place of confinement. Well, my husband gets to go do this stuff. My husband gets to go do this. I hear some of that that stuff sometimes. Now, I will say this. I think it's a good idea. I think every lady is different. Obviously, we know that. Every lady is different, right? I think that part's true. I think you can see that. Every different personalities, just like men have different personalities and things like that. I think husbands and wives, quite frankly, a lot of times don't spend enough time together. I think that's true. Meaningful time together. Talking, communicating. I didn't say you have to, we'll go out to dinner or something like that and do things. You don't have to do that. I'm just saying, but you do have to talk to each other. You do have to commune with each other. You do have to have a conversation with each other. Like, you shouldn't just be like roommates. You shouldn't just be living in the same house, look like two strangers that sleep with one another. That's not marriage. And if that's the way that it is, well, that may be why your wife looks at things like that. Right? That may be why she would. But, you know, if you ever look at your home life like that, you have to think about that. Or maybe you feel unappreciated. I could understand that. I can understand why a wife would sometimes feel unappreciated, right? I can understand why a husband would. I can understand that. There are times that we all feel that way. But you and I still have a duty before God to press on. We have a duty to be the Christians that we're supposed to be. And that's the plain path of duty. And sometimes that's hard. Sometimes that's mundane. Sometimes that's like the same thing over and over again. And sometimes that doesn't seem as glamorous as what somebody else's life is or what somebody else is doing or something else. And then you fall out of love with what your duties are before God. And you start to become cold to the ones that are around you and the ones that you're supposed to be loving. And really what it is you've become cold to Christ. Because see, Christ is the fire in the soul that keeps you burning. If you ever have to love someone, if you ever find you have a problem loving someone, you have a problem and you need to be closer to Christ, because Christ is the fire. He is the oil. He is the Holy Ghost of God is that oil that burns in the lamp bright that keeps you. That's how you can love people that hurt you. That's how you can continue to love after you've been hurt, because it's Christ's love. Right? By the way, being unappreciated is the part of the Christian life. We all unappreciate Christ, yet his love never wavers for us. This plain path of duty for us is safety. It's a safety net for us all. Wives and mothers being home with their children and building the kingdom of God through their ministry to their husbands and their children is of the utmost importance. If you ever fall out of love with that, then you need to go to Christ and return to your first love. If you would have your love strong and your way lighted in the plain path of duty, then you must press into Christ. This is one of Satan's ways to challenge your inheritance, by the way, which I haven't even got to yet. Oh my goodness. Well, we started late, so I got time. Anyway, I was looking at the clock over there. I was like, we started late, so we're good for another hour and a half. It's good. All right. Don't burn the beans over there. Somebody turn them down. It's going to be a while. By the way, this is one of Satan's ways to challenge your inheritance. You ladies. He did the same thing to Eve. That's one of your major, like, you mean, Pastor, are you saying there's like personal attacks on women and women alone that Satan has, and he crafts those attacks perfectly against them? Yeah. It's his way to challenge your inheritance. Because if enough discontent can get into you, if there's enough discontent in your heart, then you're liable to do anything. You're liable to throw your hands up and walk away. You're tired of it. You don't want to go through that anymore. You don't want to deal with that. And by the way, lady, you think you're the only one that's ever thought that before? You ever think you're the only one that's ever thought that? Now, you'd never say it because it's frightening to say, isn't it? Sure is. And you should take it to the Lord. But I'll tell you this. You're not the first one that ever thought, man, just throw your hands up and run away. Right? You don't think your husband's ever thought that before? Go hide out in a dark cave somewhere.
Yep.
Get away from everybody, not see anybody, not talk to anybody, not be around anybody. You think you're the only one that's ever thought about wanting to give up, quit, pack it in, be done? Right?
Amen.
But you know what we have to do? We have to march on. We have to continue on. We have a duty before God. Your duty is not just directly to your husband, your wife, your children. Your duty is to God. You see, what motivates me in this Christian life is that I'm pressing on the upward way. I'm going home someday, and I have a Savior to stand before. I'm going to answer to God one day. And I don't have an excuse. I can't look at God and say, well, God, I just felt like doing this. Life was so hard. I just felt like it'd be better if I did this. And God's going to look at me and say, you have no excuse, son. I don't have an excuse that I can give before God for me not to fulfill my responsibilities as a husband, as a father, and to leave the plain path of duty and to go off of it. And you don't either, as a mother who has Christ, who's been saved by the grace of God. You don't have an excuse. You don't have an excuse to give to God. You don't get to say, you know what, it was hard, God. So I just didn't want to do it. I didn't want to keep marching on. It was hard. Of course it's hard. He said it was going to be hard. It is. It's difficult to, hey, you know what? You might think it's difficult to serve people that aren't very kind and loving and appreciative. Well, now you know how Jesus felt when he came. So now you take those, now you fellowship in his sufferings. That doesn't give somebody an excuse to do wrong, and it doesn't make what they've done right. But what it does do is help you to understand how to deal with it. It makes you understand how to deal with it. It makes you understand how you're to deal with that type of rejection, right? You know what's really sad? And I've heard this before, and I'm not going to stay on here because it'll borderline on prying, which I like to do sometimes, but with a crowbar and pry things open. But I will say this. It's noticeable if you complain about your spouse. Like, it's very noticeable. If you do it, it sticks out. And by the way, it's ugly. It's very ugly. It's very ugly to complain about your husband or your wife. It's ugly. It looks really ugly. For instance, like if your husband buys you something or your wife gets something or prepares something for you and all you do is complain about it, it's ugly. I'm gonna tell you something that, and we all do it. We all can be complaining and we can just be, and some of us are just like perfectionists. You know, sometimes it doesn't matter if you like it. Shut up. Why don't you just shut up and be thankful? How about that? That you never had a pastor tell you to shut up before. Well, now you do. Right? I have to say it to myself, right? Welcome to 2022. Right? Just shut up and don't complain about it. Right? What's wrong with just being thankful and being thankful for what they've done for you? Or going to tell somebody, or, you know, you complain about somebody gets you something or gets you food or buys you food or buys you something special, and then you complain about it. Well, that's not really what I wanted. Now it is. Because it's a horrible attitude to have towards somebody doing something for you. It's a horrible attitude to have. Absolutely horrible to treat your spouse, and then to talk bad about them, or to complain about them, or to make them look bad. It's horrible. Absolutely horrible. It's ungrateful behavior. And we should be ashamed. We should be. Amen. This is one thing that I can tell you is this, that we have to do. As you're marching forward as a married couple, don't let anything come between you. Don't let your children come between you. It's a sin for you to let them come between you. It's a sin for you to let your job come between you. Your work to come between you. It's a sin for you to let anyone come between you or anything come between you. The only thing between you two is Christ. That's what brings you together. He's what brings you together. You should never let anything divide you when it comes to that. We can go on and on and on there, but man, I'll never get done. This is one of Satan's ways to challenge your inheritance as well. Never, and I mean never, entertain thoughts of disobedience to God's plan or his way. Never. Always cast them down. One of Satan's devices is to challenge your inheritance by tricking you to walk away from it or to entertain notions of it. And I would say that I don't really believe anybody wants to do that, but Satan will scare you with those thoughts of discontent or agitate you with them, and you're to cast them down, and you're to get to work. You know, the quickest way to stay out of trouble is do you get your nose to the grindstone and get to work? Discontentment finds a place in idle hearts and minds. If you're busy about the kingdom, if you're busy about the work that the Lord has given you, if you're busy about raising your family, you don't have time to be discontent because your life is full. It's when you slough off and you're like David and you're sitting on your bed when kings go out to war. And you got your mind floating around into everything. I'm talking to you women too here, especially, because you can get your mind floating around to anything and floating around into nonsense and you'll become discontent. Absolutely. It's easy to do. Remember your first mother, Eve, and the warning that was given. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 11:3, "But I fear lest by any means as the serpent beguiled at Eve through his subtlety, so your minds should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ." Marching on is that consistency. That simplicity is for you to march on. Not entertaining all these other thoughts and all these other schemes and all these other things and focus on the flesh and focus on your own mind and focus on your own problems and self-gratification and all those other things. But you're focused on the duty that God has given you. Now, which brings me to the broader point of Satan's challenges. Every inch of your inheritance will be challenged until you go home. You will not go home without it. Spiritual violence is what is necessary for us. I didn't say physical violence, I said spiritual violence. The violent take it by force. You will not go home without spiritual violence, without charging forward. You are not on a pony ride at the circus. You are not at the fair and you spend a dollar to go on a little pony ride to travel around a circle. This is no cakewalk. Although I like cake. It's no cakewalk. I like cakewalks. When I was a kid, they had those. Those are fun. Sit in the chair, you get the number drawn, you get the cake. Great. But guess what? Sorry, that's not your life. Amen. It's not a cakewalk. It's a war. That's right. That's right, girl. Be quiet back there. What are you doing? Right? The Bible says that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, right? It's a spiritual battle. I mean for you to understand that there is a principle in Scripture that shows the way through. That when you enter into this warfare, when you are saved by the grace of God, when you've come to Christ and repented and put your faith and trust in Him alone, you have an enemy and you're given armor for a reason. And it's not just to look in the mirror at and take selfie pictures of, okay? It is a battle. It is a war. It is a fight. You're given it because you have real enemies and you have real deception that comes after you. You have an adversary, and whether you fight or not, he'll fight you. And you can never take your armor off until you go home. You look at these kings in Joshua chapter 11, verse 1 through 5. It shows us that though much victory came, much victory was made, these kings still gathered up to fight them. They still went a-warring after them. And you may have given Satan many blows. He only leaves for a season. If he only left your Lord for a season, and your master for a season, he will not be done with you either. His kingdom hates everything that you stand for, so he'll come again and make war with you. A.W. Pink wisely said this. He said, "There's an old saying that any fool can make money, but it takes a wise man to keep it. Certainly it requires much diligence and care for the Christian to retain what he has acquired spiritually, to maintain the progress he has made, to consolidate that portion of his inheritance which he has entered into. For the great enemy of his souls will strive hard to deprive him thereof. He challenged our first parents in Eden while in their sinless condition, for it was abject misery unto him to see them happy." This principle runs throughout Genesis. When God prospered Abraham in Canaan and his flocks and herds increased, such strife arose between his herdsmen and Lot that they could no longer dwell together in peace. Later, the Philistines filled the earth the wells which his servants had dug. And when Isaac's men dug new ones, the men of Gerar objected, challenging their right to the same and striving with him. When Jehovah made known his purposes that Rebekah's elder son should serve the younger, she had the effrontery to contest his decision. when by means of dreams it was made known that the rest of his Joseph's brethren would be subservient to him and to pay him homage, they determined to prevent the fulfillment thereof. Even Joseph challenged the desire of his dying father to bestow his principal blessing upon Ephraim. When the Hebrews were peacefully settled in Goshen, there arose up a king who knew not Joseph, who was jealous and fiercely assailed them. And all things have been recorded for our instruction to teach us to expect that attempts will be made to dispossess us of our rightful portion. Like Satan really wants to attack you. He wants to attack your inheritance. He wants to attack your right to your inheritance. He wants you to question it. Satan blatantly and impiously assaulted the Lord Jesus Christ, challenging him to supply proof of his deity. If thou be the Son of God. And you don't think he's going to challenge you? You don't think he's going to challenge your sonship? So too, during his public ministry, again and again, he stirred up the priests and the Pharisees to demand, by what authority do you these things?
Right.
Over and over again, the authority of the believer is challenged by Satan until he goes home. Over and over again, your inheritance will be challenged. Over and over again, the devil sought to rob the apostles of their portion. How about this? So too, during his public ministry, again and again, he stirred up the priests and the Pharisees, demand by what authority they did these things. Such opposition in the parable of the wheat and the tares. No sooner had Christ sown the good seed in the field than his right thereto was challenged by Satan sowing tares therein. The devil sought to rob the apostles, right? Jesus said it unto Peter, Satan hath desired to have thee, to sift thee as wheat. But I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail thee not. And when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. I mean, the challenge is going to be there always. Right? Always. How long was it after Pentecost before the enemy stirred up Saul of Tarsus to persecute the primitive Christians and encompass the death of Stephen? No sooner had Peter been divinely sent unto Cornelius and a blessed work of grace commenced among the Gentiles than there was a determined opposition and an attempt made to bring the same to an end by denying Peter's right to evangelize the Gentiles. The book of Acts records instance after instance of attacks made upon what peace, the peace and prosperity of one church after another. All these examples show us the need of taking heed of the exhortation, hold fast that which is good. Amen? Hold fast that which is good. For the flesh, the world, and the devil will combine in seeking to get us to relinquish the same. Because of the corruptions of our heart, the temptation of Satan, the allurements of the world, we are in real danger of letting go what is more precious than rubies. Having bought the truth, we must resolutely see to it that we sell it not. Because of these attacks, we are commanded to hold fast our profession without wavering. Why? Why would you ever be commanded to hold fast your profession without wavering? Why? I mean, there's nobody going to challenge your profession. I mean, no, there's no devil, not by word, not by spirit, nor by letter. You mean Satan would really work, or your own heart, and would work and try to talk you out of your profession? Try to push doubt and fears in your mind and challenge the very work of Christ in your soul? Yeah. That's why he said, hold fast. Hold fast, brother, hold fast. That's why he said it.
Amen.
Like he wasn't saying it just to hear himself speak. He wasn't writing it just so he could read it himself and feel good about it. It was written under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost. I mean, it's not like Satan actually challenged the deity of Christ or something. Like, he didn't go to him and say, well, if thou be the Son of God, if you really are the Son of God, then turn these stones into bread. Wait, you mean he actually went to God in the flesh and he challenged God in the flesh and tried to get in Jesus' head? Yeah. Just like he gets in your head and tries to do the same to you. Yeah. Well, I mean, if you question God, then you're not going to walk by faith. You're going to walk by sight, and then you're going to be looking for warm, fuzzy little feelings all day long, and you're going to want to feel good about everything, and you're going to and your change is going to be not walking by faith, but how you feel. And you'll look for fulfillment in the way you feel. Well, you're in a lot of trouble. I'm going to tell you what. When you maximize, I'm going to say this, and this may not sound very kind, but that's okay. If you look for fulfillment in the way you feel, you are being a spiritual whore. Amen. How's that? Is that bold enough? Is that brassy enough? Is that in your face enough? That's what you're doing. Well, I don't like that. I didn't say you had to like it. I really don't care if you like it.
Right.
I said it because it's true. You're gone a whoring after your feelings instead of believing what God Almighty said in His Word. The foundation of your faith. How firm a foundation, ye saints of the Lord. Well, how firm are your feelings of a foundation? Sinking sand. And when you go a whoring after your feelings, when you go a following after them to get spiritual fulfillment, you ain't never gonna have it. And that's the lesson God will teach you. You know what God did to me? He took all my feelings and turned them upside down. You know, like when you shake something and you put it in a shaker and you like shake it out and you just like throw it out there? Well, that's what God did to me. He said, yo, you gonna trust those feelings of yours? Remember how bad that was before? I'm gonna show you. Now you're not gonna be able to trust anything like that because they're gonna be so messed up, you ain't even gonna be able to figure them out. And that's what happened to me. God should, you can't even figure them out. Lord, I don't know what I'm doing. Okay, good. Now we can start over. Now, this is what you're gonna do. You're gonna trust me. You're not going to trust your senses. You're going to trust what I said in my word. That's what you're going to do. Do you really think that Satan and his kingdom will let you go unmolested to heaven? You think he's going to like the Bible says that Satan is the god of this world, right? Like the whole world system is ran by him. So did you actually think like that you would go peacefully like you're skipping to heaven, like you're going to be like skipping like all the way, like kind of thought that, didn't you? Right? What need is there to hold fast to something that has no danger of being challenged? Do you think that devils can't smell fear? That's why a beast bites you, even a dog. When they smell fear and apprehension, they know they can attack you. Like, they know it. They know, like, if you're afraid of a dog, if you're trying to train a dog and you're trying to feed him and they got food aggression or whatever, and you're afraid to reach down there and grab that plate, like, they can smell it. If they get any apprehension, you... I watched a video one day about this, and this guy, he showed that if there's any apprehension, and the guy got bit. And the reason he got bit was because he pulled back, and that dog knew. And that dog attacked him because it knew that it could smell the fear in him. It knew it, right? That's how Satan is. That's how the devils are. They smell blood like a shark in the water, and they come and attack. We must, despite all opposition and persecution, continue in and press forward along that narrow way, which leads unto life. God's people endure to the end. Not because they're strong, but because Christ is. No matter how fiercely you be assailed, surrender not your ground, but steadfastly maintain your profession that you hold fast. It presupposes inducements to compromise and to renounce. Like, this world is always going to challenge you to compromise. Always. Like, always going to try to get you to compromise. Always, 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 always. They'll never compromise. You need to compromise. Right? They won't. They won't. Nine times in the Bible, the phrase hold fast is there. That nine is the number of the fruit of the Spirit, right? It's the fruitful life. Hebrews chapter 10 says, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. And we'll get to this in a second, man. I got to move. For he is faithful that promised. We'll get back to that verse. Revelation 2:25, but that which ye have already, hold fast till I come. I like that. I like that. Jesus tells you, you hold fast till I come. Hold fast. He's coming again, amen. Said, hold fast till I come. Revelation 3:11, behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Amen. That's that crown of faithfulness he's talking about. That no man take that crown. You hold fast. Verse 11, him that overcometh, in that same chapter, Revelation 3, verse 11 and 12 here, him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God. I like that. He keeps saying that. My God, my God, my God. And I will write upon him my new name. Amen. 1 Corinthians 9:24. Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize? So run that you may obtain. It's not the start, but it's the end which determines the fitness to wear the crown.
Right.
You got to run it out. You got to run the race out. Satan will not quit fighting. He will not quit challenging. He will never stop challenging your inheritance until you go home. He will not leave you alone for long. He has a vested interest in your defeat and your discouragement. And we are not ignorant of his devices, but we do need to be reminded of them. See, the Bible says we're not ignorant of his devices, but what do we have to be reminded of them? We got to always be in remembrance. Why? Because we forget. We forget. Hold fast. So I'm going to tell you how you hold fast here, and then we're going to get out of here. Well, maybe. We'll see. But to hold fast, number one, how do I hold fast? I watch. We need to be reminded to watch. But the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. Watch. You put a watch on your heart. You're alert. You watch, right? The Bible says, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. What does that word keep mean? It means to preserve. It means to put a watch. It means to put a guard on your heart. You guard your heart. You put a watch on your heart, right? You pay attention closely to what's going on. You watch. You're alert. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind. Be sober. And hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil is a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. Whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. No, preacher, nobody's going through what I am right now. Nobody's ever went through. I'm an anomaly. No one's ever went through anything that I'm going through right now. Nobody. No. Everything you're going through is such as is common to man.
Yep, right.
I know sometimes we think we're really special. But it's such as is common to man. It's all in the Bible. It's all there. But we have an enemy, and he will rise up, and he'll gather a gang of devils to war against us and challenge your faith. Pick holes in your profession. To watch is to be alert. See, Satan's desire is to make you question God's goodness to you, to question your sonship in Christ, to question your sincerity. The best way to answer is to resist steadfast in the faith. The anchor holds, brother, it holds. It holds. Christ is the steady rock, and he holds. Hold fast to the anchor. Hebrews 4:14 shows you that. Turn there. Hebrews 4:14 through 16. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. Why? Because of Christ. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly under the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in a time of need. How do we hold fast? Number two, by seeing Jesus. By looking at Jesus. We hold fast by remembering we have a high priest that can be touched with the feeling of our infirmities. Jesus knows our every weakness. Jesus was fully God and fully man. He suffered on this earth. He suffered through some of the things. If you would hold fast that profession, then you must look to Christ. You must remember Christ. You must fellowship in his sufferings. You must consider Christ. And then you must come boldly to the throne of grace. You have to boldly go to God. Bold prayer will strengthen your heart. Bold prayer will help you hold fast. You will not hold fast if you don't boldly pray. You can boldly pray because of Christ and who he is. Because he is the high priest that ever liveth to make intercession for us. See, so you're holding fast and your strength is because of Christ. It doesn't have anything to do with you. It has everything to do with him. That's why you hold fast. That's how you hold fast. I can come boldly because of who Jesus is. I can come boldly because of what he's done for me. Amen. Hebrews 10:23, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. Why? For he is faithful that promised. We hold fast our profession because he is faithful who promised. That's why. How do I hold fast the faithful promises of God? I believe the faithful promises of God. That's what he said. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. For he is faithful that promised. Your faith, you know, your profession is not held fast by your promise to God. You didn't promise God anything.
Amen.
When you got saved. When you got saved, he promised you everything.
Amen.
And you're saved upon his promise.
Right. Yeah.
You're saved upon what Christ said and what Christ did. You're saved because of the atonement. You're not saved because of your strength. I don't hold fast to my profession without wavering because of my strength or because of the way I feel. I hold fast because of he who promised. He is faithful. Christ is faithful who promised. No man ever was a loser that died in this life that went to heaven and believed God's promises. No man ever looked at Jesus and said, but Lord, you promised, and then he kicked him into hell. That's not consistent with the character of God.
Amen.
That might be consistent with your flippant character at times, but that's not God's character. Right? You and I, we might waver from a promise in this life that we make. Why? Because something can overpower us, or something happens to us that is outside of our knowledge and understanding. But nothing, there is nothing that God does not know. God knows everything. He's omniscient, right? And God is omnipotent. He is all-powerful, so nothing can overpower him. So then God's promises can never be overpowered, and they are always with perfect knowledge. That's why you can trust God, because of his nature and who he is. For he is faithful that promised. We are told how to hold fast our profession. We hold it fast because he is faithful. And look what he says. The way to do so is to consider one another. Look at verse 25. Not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. You want to hold fast? Then you be around people that are holding fast.
Amen.
You want to be strengthened in your faith? Then you be around people who are walking by faith. Amen? If you would hold your profession and be strong in the Lord, then you must certainly not forsake the assembling of yourselves together. You know, I've read that during this COVID, church attendance declined by a major percentage. Well, the churches were closed. What do you expect? right? And such many of the people decided they didn't need the Lord's church anymore.
Yeah.
And most churches rendered themselves useless. But God has been good to us, right? He allowed us to continue on. How else do I hold fast? By repenting. Remember, therefore, how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. Jesus said to repent, hold fast and repent. You repent any known sin. If I sin, then I confess it to God. Right? The Bible says if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We repent, we turn away from our sin. We confess our sins. Right? If you would take your sin to Christ and repent, then Satan will have nothing to torture you with. If you hold anything back with God, Satan will use it against you. He will. After we've confessed any known sin to the Lord, and we know our conscience is clear, then we declare to our own hearts. We do not allow our hearts to declare anything to us. David did this as well. You want to get in trouble? Start listening to your own heart tell you why you're not a child of God. He said, that's not possible. Yes, it is. Very possible. It's very possible for your heart to speak to you and you not to speak to your heart. Job said it. Job 27:4, my lips shall not speak wickedness, nor my tongue utter deceit. God forbid that I should justify you till I die. I will not remove mine integrity from me. My righteousness I hold fast, and I will not let it go. My heart shall not reproach me so long as I live. If you're not careful, sometimes you'll let your heart speak to you. David would speak to his own heart. Why art thou cast down, O my soul? Why art thou disquieted in me? Hope thou in God. Right? David spoke to his own heart. But there are times that you have to.
Yeah.
There are times you have to speak the truth to your own heart. No, it's impossible. My heart can always be right. And if it says that I'm really not a Christian, if I have those doubts and fears, then it must be true. Because my heart would never deceive me. Right? Right. But what do I have to do? My heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I can't trust my own heart. He that trusteth in himself is what? A fool. I don't trust my own heart. I trust Christ. Hey, Ben, I trust my superior judgment. You'll find out that ain't very superior.
Yeah.
Whew. That one will get you. Well, you might think, man, I got the gift of discernment. Yeah, you can get deceived with it too. You're not careful. Right? I have the gift of discernment. Mm-hmm.
Heard that before.
Boy, you can get tripped up with that too. Start thinking, I got some supernatural gift of discernment. Man, I know stuff. Right? Job spoke to his own heart. David spoke to his own heart. Asaph spoke to his own heart. He communed with his own heart. He said, well, look, why art thou cast down? What's the reason? Right? He spoke to his own heart. He said, that sounds crazy. I don't care what it sounds like to you. He did it. Don't tell me it's crazy. I think taking funny pills is crazy.
Yeah, come on.
I used to be a druggie and take all kinds of stuff, so that was crazy.
Yeah.
Believing God and his word is not crazy.
Right.
I've seen crazy, believe me. Lots of it. But I know what God's word says. Be careful, though, that in your battles that you don't allow your heart to condemn you and speak noisily to you. But that you speak the truth to your own heart. There's a time that you have to do that. That your heart will wish to indict you. And one of Satan's tactics is to use a person's poor diseased mind or heart against them. To use their own disease, depression against them. Satan will most assuredly come to attack us. And we have to be ready to resist him steadfast in the faith. We have to be ready to do that. So that sounds kind of crazy, you talking to yourself like that. Really? Sounds kind of biblical. Because
yep.
When you go through the Psalms, a lot of those are reflections.
Yes.
And a lot of those, they're speaking and they're praying to God, but they're also speaking to their own heart.
Yep.
communing. David said he would commune with his own heart on his bed. He would sit there. So if he was troubled, he would commune with his own heart. But what would he do? Would he let his heart just run like with diarrhea of the mouth and just take off and just tell him everything? No. See, if you do that, if you let your own heart tell you everything and you don't tell your heart what God's word says, then you're being an idolater. Because you're listening to your own heart and you're not speaking the word of God to your own heart. This, brethren, this is the basis of all truth, not your heart. This book is the basis of all truth. This is the foundation. This is the final authority. It's not my heart. It's not my feelings. It's not. No, this is. So then if my heart, then I judge my own heart by the word of God. I judge my own thoughts by the word of God. I judge everything by the authority of the scriptures. Amen. And then if I do that, then I can speak to my own heart and I can say, hope thou in God. Hope thou in God.
Amen.
That's what I speak to my own heart. No, hope thou in God. Right? Why art thou cast down, O my soul? Why art thou disquieted in me? Hope thou in God. For I shall yet praise him for the health of his countenance. Right? I shall yet praise him. I shall yet praise God. Wait, I don't feel like praising God. I didn't ask you what you felt like doing, and neither did God. You have a duty to praise God. It doesn't matter how you feel. You're to praise God in everything. Your life is not your own. Would you just get over you and figure out, like, your life is not yours? When Jesus Christ saved your soul, you're no longer yours. What do you mean, I'm owned by God? I hope so. Man, I hope you are.
Amen.
I hope you don't mind being the Lord's slave.
Amen.
Right? I hope you don't have a problem with that today. Man, I don't know if I like God telling me what to do. Man, I sure do. Because I know what mess I was making of my life before God started telling me what to do. Amen? How bad of a mess did you make your life before God started telling you what to do? Before God was your Lord and Master? Before he was your Savior? Well, you might say, well, I got a pretty good life. I'm a pretty good person. Who are you comparing yourself to? You or God? You comparing yourself to the people around you? Are you comparing yourself to Christ? Because if you're comparing yourself to Christ, you're like dung.
Yeah.
That's what we are. I don't think of myself that low. Well, you should. Because the Bible says that is in my flesh dwelleth no good thing. God's word, the authority, says that you're exceedingly sinful. And without Christ, you deserve to die and go to hell. That's what God's word says. And the only thing good that can be good in you is Christ. Well, I think I'm pretty good. Man, I don't. I think I'm pretty rotten. I think if I was left to my own devices, I would be the most wicked man alive. Right? If God didn't save my soul, I know where I was heading. And it was hell. Right? You've got to hold fast. The warning that we're given in the scriptures, one of the last times we're told to hold fast, says, let no man take thy crown. You have to march on. These kings, as the sand of the sea with their troops came after them, they're facing their biggest challenge to date right here. All the past victories Joshua had and everything, now all these kings have gathered together as the sand of the sea, these troops. And they're in for the battle. They're in for the war. And so are you. And Satan wants to challenge your inheritance. He wants to tell you that you don't get to have it. Like, it's not really yours. Like, God really doesn't love you. And you're not really God's. And you don't really get to have that inheritance. And God doesn't really love you. And you're not really his child. So, you know, God wouldn't accept you because you sinned and you did this and you did that and you've done this and you've done that. But why play mind games with the devil? Why not just say, yeah, I did all that and Jesus paid for all that? You really don't have to argue with Satan about how wicked you are. You can just agree with him. Right? There's nothing wrong with that. You're right. But Jesus isn't. But Jesus is pure. Jesus is holy. Jesus is righteous. right? Jesus paid my sin debt. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin hath left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. You're to hold fast your profession without wavering. You're to trust and believe God, and you're to march on. That's the command of God. That's your duty. Father, Lord, thank you. Thank you for making it so plain for us. Thank you that all of our righteousness is as filthy rags, but everything you did is perfect and holy. Thank you that you paid our sin debt for us. Thank you that you died for my wickedness, my rotten soul. And then you breathed life and saved us and washed us and gave us eternal life. And Lord, if there be any here that have never received that, never been supernaturally changed by the Spirit of God, may they come to Christ today, have their sins forgiven, be born again, be given a suit of armor, and sent out to battle for you. Thank you for the fight. Thank you for the battle. Give us safety, Lord, till you deliver us home. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.